Hello and welcome to Edukimi's YouTube channel. My name is Harsh Singh and in this video we shall discuss the Gazette magazine for 16 September 2021, your daily guide to UPSC current affairs. Now, the new snapshots today are, one, and India and Singapore having a pact on the monetary transfer. The second one is on a report on indebtedness by SBI. The third one is a debt and investment survey. This talks about the disparity in the income in the household. Feature news of the day is on the unorganized sector, and this is on a different video. Now, in this segment, we will understand what is the significance of unorganized sector, contributing to almost 50% of India's GDP and 90+% of the workforce of the country. And therefore, we will understand what are the issues they go through. We will understand what is the constraining factor and how the government is trying to remove them. This is on a separate video, and rest of the discussion on the second video that you're watching. Image of the day on Gatka, a Sikh tradition. Terms and concepts that we discussed today are National Asset Reconstruction Company, Tarballs, Project Udaan, and AGR. Editorials of the day. The three editorials that we discuss are, first one on the value of economic equality in a country. And the second one is about the reforms between center and state, especially related to GST. And the third one is on climate finance. This is in lieu of the India-US climate partnership. Case study of the day is from Ladakh. Let's start the discussion. We have dedicated this day in history to World Ozone Day. This is in respect to understanding the significance of ozone layer for Earth's life and atmosphere. We have discussed Montreal Protocol in detail in one of the featured news. All you got to do is type Montreal Edukemi on YouTube and you will find that video. Snapshot one is on India and Singapore relations with respect to transfer of money. It is often said that to be able to become better, one needs to have the company of better. And Singapore is one of the advanced countries which is into financial services. In fact, India is one of those countries which receives its FDI, one of the maximum FDIs from Singapore. And having a financial pact with Singapore on ease of transfer of money is one thing India could have looked for. And India has already gained it. Now, UPI and Singapore's PayNow have had a pact for ease of transfer of money. India has got a huge number of population, huge number of people working in Singapore. And therefore, it will not only help in ease of transfer of remittances, the salaries earned, it will also help in faster trade agreements, boost trade ties. It will also be able to make India more accessible to the global markets, because Singapore as it is one of the hubs for the global market. Singapore is located at one of the places which is a transshipment port. And therefore, the trade, the sea marine trade also will get a boost, because India will have a faster transport of money. This will also lead to better financial inclusion between the people, the Indian people living in Singapore. Snapshot 2 is on the report on indebtedness. This has been released by State Bank of India. Now, it is very natural that during COVID times, there was a fall in the revenue of the government, revenue earnings. So there was less taxation, correct? There was also an increase in the debt of the government. So debt to GDP ratio of the government also decreased with time. We have studied all this, right? If you type debt to GDP Edukemi, you will find those articles. Now, the debt to GDP ratio of the country increased from 60 to almost 90%, right? With internal debt and external debt. Similarly, you know, this debt has increased for the government, but don't you think that this has happened to the individuals as well? Yes, they have lost jobs, there have been no salary hikes, and therefore it has been seen that there's been an increase in indebtedness in the rural and urban areas both. In fact, in the last 5 years, if seen, the indebtedness has increased 84%. 84% in the last 5 years in the rural areas, and as much as 42% in the urban areas. Although half of rural areas, but you can still see the humongous amount of debt people are under because of COVID times. Not only this, it says that there has been a formalization of rural economy. How can formalization of rural economy be interpreted through indebtedness? Very easy. See, if the debt has been taken by individual household or an informal person or through formal credit mechanism, right? So formal credit mechanism is Kisan Credit Card. So we have seen an increase in the rise of the formalization of debtedness, right? So this is a very good mechanism, because now informal taking of money, microfinance, has been reduced. So this is a good development, but yes, debtedness is a problem for the country. Snapshot 3 is on disparity in India. This report has been released by National Statistical Organization, and it is called as All India Debt and Investment Survey. Now, the most important striking fact this report states is that the richest 10% in the country, The richest 10% in the country owe around 50% of physical and financial assets. 50%. And the lower 50% of the people in India, they owe only around 10% of the assets. Now, this is not a very tough statistics to remember. Released by NSO, a credible organization, all you have to do is write it down at a place so that you can repeat it somewhere, right? Again, the report goes on to say that the rural areas face the maximum amount of disparity in the country. Rural areas face maximum amount of disparity. The third important fact is a state like Delhi, and then we have Punjab. These are the two states which have seen maximum disparity in having financial assets, physical assets. So Delhi, top 10% people have got 80% of the assets. Top 10% people have got 80% of the assets. These are the examples you can just throw anywhere and you will be proved credible everywhere. So rest of the article, if you want, quickly you can go through if you have the Gazette magazine. Image of the day is on the tradition of Gatka. This Gatka tradition is followed by the Sikh people, right? So this was demonstrated on the 50th anniversary of India's Swarnim Vijay Varsh. Swarnim Vijay Varsh. Now this is 50 years of the 1971 war with Pakistan, and therefore this Gatka tradition was performed. Now what is Gatka? Gatka is a tradition. It is a martial art performance by the Sikh people after the fifth guru. After the fifth guru was killed by the Mughals, fifth guru is the Guru Arjan Dev. His son initiated this Gatka performance. So in Gatka performance, there are various rituals carried, and these are martial art techniques of using sword. This is what was performed in the Gatka culture tradition. The first term in news is National Asset Reconstruction Company. Now, this is a very simple concept of bad bank. Now, there are many banks which give loans. That's true. And the loans sometimes are defaulted. They are not paid back to the bank in time. And if there is an accruing amount of loans, if these kind of loans which are not performing, these become part of non-performing asset, then this is a liability for the bank. The credible balance sheet of the bank, it gets disturbed, and therefore bank wants to release these kind of assets, the liable assets with itself. So it has got the liability of the person who has given money. Liability is in the form of some of the physical assets, gold, all those things. But bank does not perform all that kind of transaction, no? So bank will transfer these kind of non-performing assets to the National Asset Reconstruction Company, right? They will be purchasing the assets from the bank. They will give the bank a certain due amount, and they will keep this asset. And now they will try to recover the asset. How will they recover? They will recover through various means. One of the means is selling the asset. One of the means is another bid for the asset. Another means is through coercion. So there are various means which will be applied. And therefore, after the acquirement of the asset by National Asset Reconstruction Company, another company which will be called as India Debt Resolution Company. This debt resolution company will take over the asset, and it will try to resolve that debt, right? Now, in case they are not able to handle it, government is also backing this fund by 30,000 crore rupees. So this is what is National Asset Reconstruction Company and the India Debt Resolution Company. Both of them form a part of the bad bank system in India. The second term in use is tar balls. Whenever there is marine spillage through these marine vessels, these spills later react with sunlight and water, and they form small balls. These balls are hand size, but slowly and steadily they start to accumulate, and they start to flow towards the coast areas. And this is what results in the formation of tar balls. These are not good for the marine biodiversity. These are not good for aesthetics of the marine sphere. Third term is Project Udaan. It is an IIT Bombay project, an artificial intelligence derived project, and it is about converting the English material, English content of the technical and non-technical books into the regional content. So this is how we are trying to ensure financial, trying to ensure educational and digital inclusion in our country. Yesterday itself we studied what is happening to the school going children when there is language only in the English content. So Project Udaan is going to enable transfer of this content into regional language. The fourth term in news is adjusted gross revenue. Now, this is about the revenue which the companies have incurred, the private telecom operators have incurred. They have two kind of revenues that they have. One is the core business and one is the auxiliary business. Auxiliary business could be related to selling of the assets. It could be related to gaining some kind of privileges, some kind of revenues, etc. So these are the non-core business. So the difference between the government and the private companies is that what should constitute the part of the adjusted gross revenue, because part of this revenue has to be paid back to the government.
Welcome back. Similar learnings, but from new platform. Now, this is the editorial section, and the first editorial is on economic equality in our country. Now, the editorial begins by saying that any functional system needs certain recalibrations. some reformation, some tendencies which are undesirable and they have to be removed. Similarly, just like India claims to be the largest democracy, a place where free and fair elections happen, do they actually happen in a free and fair way? Or is it mired with controversies, people are fearful, and there is favoritism also? So these are the kind of calibrations we have to do at various other places. It moves ahead to say that democracy is a place where people discuss, they debate, they disagree also. This is that space. But the public space in which the disagreements happen, that has started to reduce. The public spaces are shrinking where constructive discussions can happen in our country, right? This is where it goes on to say that inequality has actually been the basis of our culture, Indian culture, right from the previous ancient and medieval times. We have always seen the concept of prince and the concept of pauper. There is always a pauper, a poor person, and a prince. The king always exists, and then we have subjects of the king. And there is a difference in the rights the king avails and the rights the praja, the subject avails, right? So democracy in modern times is not an end in itself. It is a means to provide ends. For example, it is an important way in which people can choose who to vote for. Democracy is an important methodology through which people can demand for economic equality. This is what democracy stands for. And yes, Indian democracy is accommodative in nature in multiple ways, because we have accepted social economic inequality. We have accepted the cultural inequality. Yes, that is true. But what is the job of power? The job of power is to help people. On the other hand, it is not helping people. It is showing the power against the powerless. So power is actually serving the needs of the powerful itself. Power, the definition of power is the ability to get work done. However, power has been used against the powerless people. But ideally, in an egalitarian setup, the extreme phase of democracy, where everybody is provided equal rights in all spheres, there is no existence of power. Yes, India cannot have egalitarian system. However, India can definitely utilize power to give services to the poor people. So decentralization in the country today is not happening to be able to transfer rights to the powerless people. It is only serving the interest of specific people, right? Today, leaders in the country are vanishing, and we have effective administrators, effective police officers, effective IAS officers. But the concept of leadership has vanished. Concept of the space in which people could discuss and debate issues, that has reduced, right? And people are already happy with the status quo. They do not want this kind of change. They are already well established with the system of stable and continuity in the present democratic setup. Now, one good example of this is the migrant workers. See, crime is defined by law, but it is detected by the state. Yes. So migrant workers, who are they? Were they criminal by law? No. But during the time of the COVID, when there was lockdown announced, look at the treatment migrant workers were given. So this is a very simple example of how power was used against the powerless, right? This is where the editorial says that migrant workers, tribal people, marginalized people, all are subjected to this kind of discrimination. Economic equality also becomes very important tool to have democracy in the country. And this is where it says that MNREGS scheme, this should not be only used for creating assets. This should give power, economic equality to the people. And the last statement becomes very important. It's a very beautiful statement. It says that the underclass, that the unprivileged class, they should not only be treated as recipients, the passive recipients of any kind of work or welfare mechanism. They can also be treated as potential producers, those people who can drive the economy of the country. We also discuss in today's the featured news itself, the power of unorganized workers, the power of unorganized worker, as much as 90% of population of the workforce and 50% of GDP contribution. This is what they contribute. And we have to give them economic equality now, right? We can associate them as the freely associated producers. The second editorial is on the GST meet, which is going to be held between the center and the state governments. The editorial begins by saying that there's going to be a GST council meet very soon, and center and the state governments will again fight over the sharing of revenue. The revenue has definitely dropped in the last 1.5 years, reason being COVID, reason being the effective tax rate, which has fallen by 3%. So taxation rate has fallen. It has got nothing to do with GST. It has got more to do with the economic difficulties. It has got more to do with the policy actions of the government. So we cannot blame taxation here. So this is why the revenues have fallen. Yes, of course, revenues have started to rise right now in the latest time. But we are talking of the period of the last 1.5 years. Now, the editorial goes on to say that state should stop demanding for compensation now. It has already been 5 years for demanding compensation. What should be the new mechanism should be of revenue insurance. In case the states fall short of collecting a minimum amount of revenue, the central government should ensure that they will provide certain degree of revenue in case they fall short. So this is one mechanism. It says, the editorial also says that there should be a revenue buffer which should be kept with the states in case of COVID emergency times. Right, so COVID emergency and other emergency times. This is another recommendation. The editorial says that there is a definite need for rationalizing the GST structure. Presently, we have so many levels of taxation, 0, 12, and 18, 28, etc. Right, so it has to be rationalized and taxes have to be brought in a structure so that it is ease for everybody to collect taxes and to give taxes. And therefore, it says that revenue neutral rate. Remember, we have discussed revenue neutral rate. So this is the rate at which the center should be taxing so that the revenue, effective revenue collected will be neutral. It should not change. So new taxation regime should tax at a rate which should ensure that the revenue collected is as same as what it was collected previously. So for requirement of this, and even 15th Financial Commission, they have recommended that there must be simplification of the GST structure, right? And end of the editorial, the editorial speaks about building consensus in the GST Council. It says that states and center should build consensus, and that is how GST Council meet should be organized, because states also are a part of the federal and they also have power. And therefore, it says that probably one of the opposition chief ministers could act as the vice chair of the GST Council meet. The third editorial provides a very valuable insight into the climate demands of India and what America or developed countries are expecting from a country like India. The editorial begins by saying that US Special Envoy on Climate, who is John Kerry, he has visited India twice in the last 6 months. What is the reason? The reason is very simple. India has got increased business opportunities in the coming 10 years. Why? Because of India's plan to invest in 450 gigawatt of clean energy capacity. And therefore, America wants more business in India, right? Therefore, they had this climate action and finance mobilizing dialogue. Now, in 2009, the COP, Conference of Parties, held in Copenhagen, Denmark, it said that there'll be finances from the developed world to developing world, $100 billion per annum. But there was no development on this particular issue of financing climate, right? Now, India was expecting concessional financing, but India might not be getting the concessional filing. India might have to fund through the market mechanism. Yes, India will do that. And there is a lot of market which is coming in. We have seen the example of America. We know France is assisting India in solar capacity in multiple ways, right? And therefore, there is more clarity required in the country as to which activities constitute the green activities where investment has to be done. So instead of greenwashing means just talking about it and showing it on the surface and doing nothing below, right? So greenwashing, simple example, I used to tell, yes, I'm preparing for civil service examination, but I knew what was happening behind, right? So that is greenwashing. Now, greenwashing should not be done. Instead, data disclosure should be done. Instead, regulations should be framed and standardizing of green rating should be done so that we have a clear mechanism for how green energy will be calculated, where are the places where transformation is required, where change is required, right? And this is how we'll be able to finance and scale our capacity in green energy, right? Now, green energy is costly in India. One reason is that it has got initial establishment cost, which will be costly in India. And the second reason is the unproven efficiency. We don't know how much returns it will give, how much people will be able to accept it in the initial go. So there are various reasons because of which it is going to be expensive right now. Now, there's another cost getting added, that is climate vulnerability. Climate does not show the impact of its change immediately. The impact that we are doing to the climate right now, the changing climate and global warming, the impact will be shown in the coming 20 to 50 years. This is what the editorial says. There's a lag of 20 to 50 years. And therefore, we not only have to mitigate the greenhouse gases, we have to learn to adapt. Because even if we become net zero by 2050, the impact that we have done in 2020 and 2025, that will show up around 2050. So we have to start investing in adaptation as well. This is one very, very important critical area. So adaptation to these natural disasters, we have increased floods, increased hot waves, right? So we are talking of Lou, increase of tropical cyclones. So these are what we have to really adapt to right now, right? We are investing at the domestic capacity level, right? And we are aiming mainly at mitigation. That means to decrease the global warming, right? So greenhouse gases should be reduced. This is what we are investing at. What we have to invest majorly at is adaptation to the changes. So resilience of the infrastructure institutions is also important. And also what is important is large scale deployment. That means scalable energy initiatives, right? So these are two important requirements the editorial says towards its end. Today's case study is of Meme Chonjor from Ladakh. And this very well reminds me of the Dashrath Manji quote from the movie Manji. It said, Shandar, Zindabad, Zabardast. And this is what this person has shown again. Now, this is an old man who has retired from a government job and he built the roads in the interiors of Ladakh by his own money. He invested his own 50 lakh rupees and he also sold his own personal land so that he could build road for the people of that particular region. This shows not only indomitable spirit, this also speaks about perseverance, dedication, public service. Right. So the spirit of altruism is shown in Meme Chonjor's natural traits. Right. Now, he organized his finances, but that was not the only difficulty. Another difficulty was the geographical constraint. The place Ladakh is at high altitude. Right. There is a decreased amount of oxygen. The time in which the construction happened, that season also is reduced because there are cold times and there the construction stops at those times. So therefore, despite of these difficulties, he initiated the connectivity movement and he did build the road. He built 38 kilometers of road. There are many examples throughout the country of this. There's one IOS officer in Manipur. His name is Armstrong Pame and I have met him. He is one of the persons who has constructed road from his village to one of the important areas where medical facilities could be there. Right. So there are immense examples and you also will become one of the examples provided you keep studying. Right now is the time to study. Be disciplined. These are COVID times. All you got to do is take care of yourself and keep studying every day so that you succeed in the pre and mains examination. If you like our effort, the least you can do is like this video or share this or put a comment. And if you subscribe to the channel, you will receive timely updates. Thanks for watching.